We're here at the Physical Modeling Lab at UMass Amherst. I'm here with Kevin Tenenbaum. So Kevin, can you tell me, what is physical modeling?
Well, physical modeling is a technique that we use to allow us to study natural processes that occur over time scales and length scales that we can't observe in any other way.
So, do you want to tell us quick what this is, what we're standing next to?
This is our deformation box. And so we grow our faults in this. We first pour the clay. And we can either pre-cut faults or not, and then we can displace the box, and that displacement will grow faults.
Okay, so one side of the box moves, and then you say, oh, there's a fault, and then you take this ruler and you measure it?
So, not quite. We use these high-resolution digital cameras to record the entire process, and then we use particle image velocimetry to analyze displacements on the surface. We're going to be modeling a strike-slip fault system. So we'll be growing our faults in a wet kaolin, and it's a clay, it's a wet clay, and it has the consistency of about a Greek yogurt.
Okay, so you can grow faults in something that's the consistency of yogurt?
Yeah, so we can actually see little fractures and then slip along those fractures and create faults.
Hi, my name is Alex. We recently published a paper in the Journal of Structural Geology about how strike slip faults grow and how they evolve mechanically over time. We did these experiments in the UMass Physical Modeling Lab. So our goal is mainly to understand how these initiating strike slip faults evolve mechanically. We know how strike slip faults really evolved from these small echelon fractures to growing a through-going fault, but what is not really well known is how these faults evolve mechanically over time. We varied about three different parameters in our experiments. So the first parameter was the nature of the fault. So it was either pre-cut or uncut. When the fault was pre-cut, we were trying to give the system some pre-existing structure to localize strain onto. And when we have an uncut experiment, that's more similar to what's going on in the crust. And so we were hoping to see these echelon fractures grow first and then the through-going fault grow after that. We also varied the condition of basal shear. So we had two experiments. We had the localized experiment where we had two plates just abutting against each other, and that would be localizing the basal shear. And the distributed basal shear is the opposite. And we had a small elastic band between the two plates to simulate more of a distributed shear zone in the crest, which is what we think is actually happening in the lower crust. And then the third parameter we varied was the thickness of the clay. So we either had a shallow or a deep set of faulting. So the shallow experiments were only 2.5 centimeters thick, and then the deep ones were about 5 centimeters thick. So just to give a wide range of boundary conditions. So the PLS experiment is our simplest experiment. The pre-cut fault, the localized basal shear, and the shallow depth of faulting. So this experiment is essentially a control for the rest of the experiments because it gives us an idea of how faulting in the clay will behave over time. So this is our most basic experiment, so that way we can compare everything back to this background level. And then the UDD experiment is the most complex set of boundary conditions. It's probably most like what's going on in the crust. So that has an uncut fault, distributed basal shear over a deep dislocation. So essentially the UDD is going to be giving us the most complex evolution of faulting, the most number of faults, and that is most likely what's going on in the crust. So we were tracking what we call kinematic efficiency throughout these experiments, and efficiency is basically the ratio between displacement on a fault to the displacement that we impose on the box from our motor. So as the strikes of faults are growing, we want to know how good are they at accommodating the strain that's coming into the system. Even though it's a straight fault and it appears mature, there are some small long wavelength, low amplitude types of irregularities along the fault. And we do see this in crustal faults and think, oh, a mature fault shouldn't have these irregularities. But we see that in our clay box, that's not necessarily true. And so these experiments were really cool because they allowed us to see millions of years, about 60 million years worth of tectonic evolution that takes place over huge length scales. Basically over a few hours within our own lab. So it's a really powerful way to look at a process that we'd never be able to observe in the field.